Let me start off this video with a quote. Knowing your customers is great. Knowing how your customers behave is even better. This quote is by John Miller. The essence of this lovely quote is encapsulated in this beautiful book, Cashvertising by Drew Eric Whitman. So when I came across this book, Cashvertising, as one of the must-read books for every marketing professional out there, my first thought was, given the name, isn't it something to do with finances and numbers, etc.? But I was mistaken, because when I came across the index itself of this book, I knew I was up for a great ride. Because there's just so many points included in this book that you are bound to learn so many things out of it. Of course, it wouldn't be possible for me to include everything of this wonderful book in this particular video, because I think it might anyway be long. But I am including the best part or my favorite part from the book, which is 17 foundational psychological principles that work really well in the space of marketing. So if you're interested in finding out about these 17, and trust me, the 17th one, which is the last one, is actually the best one. So ensure that you watch the video right till the end to know all of these 17 principles and learn from it. Without further ado, let's get started. So let's look at the first one.
Number one, the fear factor. Selling the scare.
Yes, fear sells. Now, this has been so very evident across brands and categories. You see this in case of insurance ads, you see this in case of SEAT tires or any other tire company brand or something like that. Through their advertising communication, they push your consumer to be scared and then buy into your product. Like in case of an insurance ad, you might come across a communication that says that if you do not act today, your family is at a risk when you die. So you're pushing the consumer to react today for his or her future. Okay, so fear as a part in advertising or marketing works brilliantly.
Number two, ego morphing, instant identification.
Now, according to this principle, there are a lot of brands which focus on putting themselves as someone who is very arrogant, okay? So, for the longest period of time, brands have been developing these human-like personalities where they try to associate a particular quality, a human quality, to themselves, okay? So, arrogance is mentioned in this book through an example of the Marlboro Man. Now, a lot of people at that point of time when the Marlboro communication came in were not buying Marlboro only for cigarettes. They were more so inclined to buy the product because they could associate themselves with the Marlboro Man, who was this aspirational kind that the consumers definitely connected with. Even in the Indian scenario, we see a lot of luxury brands like watches or any other category talking about this arrogance and making the consumers feel like if you buy my product or my brand, you stand apart from the rest.
Number three, transfer, credibility by osmosis.
Now, this concept or this principle believes that your ad is as good as the credibility it brings in. Now, you might want to talk about how good your brand is, but unless and until it develops that kind of credibility, it's not going to work in your favor. How do you ensure that the credibility comes through your ad campaign? Best way of doing it is to incorporate the perfect brand endorser. Now, who's a brand endorser? Let me explain this with the help of an example, of course. The example is that of Sachin promoting Boost and the tagline, Boost is a secret of my energy. Now, this tagline has been so very famous and it's worked brilliantly for the brand because of the credibility it brings in when Sachin is the one talking about it. So what the brand is actually doing is that when they mention the tagline, Boost is a secret of my energy, they are trying to say that the energy that Sachin has, who has, by the way, amazing fan following, his secret is Boost. So it caters to all of those mothers who are interested in ensuring that their kids also have the same kind of energy that Sachin does. It works brilliantly for the brand.
Number 4. The bandwagon effect. Give them something to jump on.
Now, according to this book, there are basically three groups that consumers usually want to be a part of. So your communication has to be centered around either of these three groups. What are these groups? Number 1. Aspirational. This is the group where your consumer wants to belong to. Second. Associative. This is the group that the consumer connects with very well because of their ideals and values. And the last group is that of dissociative group. Now, this is a group where your consumers do not want to belong. So your communication can be catered towards either of these groups, and that can work in your favor.
Number 5. The means end chain. The critical core.
Now, this principle relies on the statement that do not buy my product for today. Buy my product for tomorrow. So, what it focuses on is that your brands need not be used for immediate consumption. They, however, can have long-lasting effects. So, as I've mentioned earlier, life insurance policies and communication by life insurance policy companies catered or moves or revolves around this particular area of ensuring that your customer is not buying your products for today but are actually securing their future.
Number 6. The trans-theoretical model. Step-by-step persuasion.
Now, according to this particular principle from the book, your consumer persuasion takes place through these 6 stages. These are, number 1, pre-contemplation stage. In this case, in this stage, your consumer is not aware of your product or is ignorant towards it. The second stage is that of contemplation. Now, when it comes to contemplation, your consumer is considering or researching about your product. The third stage is that of preparation. Now, with preparation, what the consumer is trying to look at is just trying to find out a little more information about what you have to offer through your product. The fourth stage is that of action. Here, the consumer has reached a stage where he or she is willing to buy into your product. And the last stage is that of maintenance. Now, when it comes to maintenance, what it means is that your consumer has not only bought the product, but is also using your product in day-to-day life.
Number 7. The inoculation theory. Make them prefer you for life.
Now, the inoculation theory believes that you need to reinforce this thought in your consumer's mind that what they've purchased is actually good. You do this by including or introducing a weak argument and then come up with a defense theory which promotes your product or your brand. This can be done in 3 steps. Number 1. Warn of an impending attack. Let's take an example. You just put in a thought in the consumer's mind that having germs around your area where you're living, in your living room, in your bedroom, etc., germs can be dangerous. It's just an impending attack that you're putting in. Number 2. Make a weak attack. Here, you tell the consumers that yes, you are using a disinfectant spray, but it's not really helping you get rid of all the germs. Number 3. Encourage a strong defense. Now, in this case, what you're trying to communicate to your consumers is that, hey, use my brand disinfectant spray and you will get amazing results which will ensure that there are no germs in the area you're operating in. Okay, so you're making a strong defense in the form of promoting your product or your brand.
Number 8. Belief re-ranking. Change the reality.
Fortunately, there are ways in which consumer beliefs can be changed, and it's important to note that there are ways or there are brands who've incorporated just this. The most crucial belief that you need to change in a consumer's mind is making them believe that they do not need your product. Okay, so that's a belief that consumers have. But as a brand, you need to ensure that you change that belief. We can take an example of Ola in this case. Before Ola was introduced in the market, we always believed that we can survive through public transport and other facilities that, you know, we come across for transportation. But when Ola was introduced, they ensured that they are changing this consumer belief that surviving on the current way of commuting may not be the right way, and you have better options in case you wish to, you know, get into an Ola.
Number 9. The elaboration likelihood model. Adjust their attitude.
Now, according to the elaboration likelihood model, it states that consumers can be targeted or their attitudes can be changed through two routes. Number 1, which is the central route. In this, you're using logical reasoning and, you know, giving exact examples and giving reasons to your consumers to buy your product. The other way is through the peripheral route, wherein you try to associate positive images with your brand just so that it helps the consumers choose your brand over someone else.
Number 10. The 6 weapons of influence. Shortcuts to persuasion.
Now, this comprises of the 6 weapons commonly known by the mnemonic Clarks. Number 1, comparison. Everyone else is doing it. Why aren't you? Second, liking. You like me, hence do as I say, buy. A, authority. The person in the white coat is saying this. Hence, it has to be the truth. R, reciprocation. I gave you a freebie, so you have to do something that I'm asking for, buy my product. Next, consistency or commitment. Constantly be in touch about your product and offer something that will ensure that there are repeat purchases. And lastly, scarcity. Now, I have only limited things to offer, so ensure you buy before the next one comes in.
Number 11. Message organization. Attaining critical clarity.
No matter how amazing your product might be, clarity is always going to take precedence. And this is very important to understand and know. You might want to talk about 100 things through your communication, but what matters at the end of it is that your consumers understand what exactly are you trying to communicate. Because as a simple logic, if they do not understand what you're trying to communicate, they cannot be persuaded.
Number 12. Examples versus statistics. And the winner is...
And the clear winner is examples. Think about it from a logical point of view, guys. Do not just think about it or listen to it as I'm saying. But it's a simple understanding that advertising communication is always encountering a consumer who is not 100% attentive. Okay? So if you bombard the consumer with statistics on this is how we conducted the research founding stated something like this. 20% out of those people were doing this, 29% of those people were doing that, etc. I am not going to be interested. I would rather be given an example that portrays the exact point, but at the same time is not, you know, giving me additional information that I may not be interested in, right? I am only getting those points, and I'm getting only that information which is important to me and is serving the purpose of selling the brand.
Number 13. Message sideness. Dual role persuasion.
Now, competitive advertising is not a new phenomenon, guys, right? Brands across categories have been indulging in some form of competitive advertising throughout the years. But what's more important when it comes to competitive advertising is, understanding the correct way of doing it. If your competitive advertising is only focused around bashing your competitor and saying that they are like literally the worst product out there and it's not something you should buy into, then that's not going to really connect with your consumers. But a better way of incorporating competitive advertising is if you talk about your product and how your product is better than the competitor. Now that works because your consumer might be using the competitor product and might be taken aback with the findings that you have put in, which talk about why your brand is better. And hence that consumer might then switch to your brand.
Number 14. Repetition and redundancy. The familiarity factor.
Now they say an advertisement does not really affect a consumer unless and until he or she has seen it at least 7 times, okay? So it's not that the person is going to look at your ad for the first time and then be convinced to buy into the product. Of course, I'm not saying that that's not happening at all, okay? It will, but that's a very, very rare possibility. So 7 times a consumer might come across your ad, and each of these 7 times he might get a little more influenced to try out what you're offering.
Number 15. Rhetorical questions. Interesting, aren't they?
Rhetorical questions serve an advertiser's purpose in the most innovative way possible. Now, it's a given fact that, as I mentioned earlier, a consumer is not going to be 100% attentive when they are looking at your advertising communication. But it's important to note that if you slip in a rhetorical question into your communication, it's bound to have a better impact with the consumers. And it's not just something I'm saying, it's proven through research that a rhetorical question actually has a bigger and a greater impact on consumers.
Number 16. Evidence. Quick, sell me the facts.
You need to be quick, guys. You need to be definitely quick in understanding what you need to communicate and how soon can you communicate it. Now, it's all about, your entire communication needs to revolve around understanding or answering this one question, which is extremely crucial to your consumers. The question of what's in it for me? What am I getting out of this? Okay, you've told me that your brand is better than a brand X, and I should be opting for your product, and these are the things that your brand offers, someone else does not offer, etc., etc. But what's in it for me? Unless and until, as a marketer or an advertiser, you do not answer this question in your communication, it's not going to have the kind of effect you're expecting it to have.
Lastly, heuristics. Serving billions of lazy brains daily.
According to this principle, your communication needs to be on the right track to interest your consumers to buy in. So your communication might be extremely creative. It may be something that has really worked for you from a humor perspective. You know that consumers come across your ad and find it really funny. But is it in the right track? Is it communicating the kind of message that your consumers are interested in knowing or listening to? Okay? You need to psychologically be able to track that chord in your consumer's mind and link it to your brand. Unless and until that happens, you cannot be assured that your communication is on the right track. That's it for today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed and learned something out of it. I understand that this video was sort of longish as compared to what I've uploaded in the past. But these 17 principles are so amazing, and there's just so much to learn that I did not want to let go of either of them. So I ensured to include all of them. Let me know in the comments below which principle has been like really motivating for you, inspiring for you to incorporate in your next marketing strategy whenever the time comes in. Of course, before you leave, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel by hitting the bell notification icon so that you get notified the next time we upload another marketing book summary video. Until next time, bye-bye.